welcome all of you to the service of worship and invite everyone to sign the friendship register, which you will find in the center of each aisle. And after you've signed it, please pass it to those seated next to you that we may have record of everyone's attendance. This morning, immediately following this worship service, we will have a congregational meeting for all members. However, our guests who are here this morning are welcome at the last verse to leave the sanctuary. And I'll ask if our ushers, if the ushers would be willing to greet the guests who are here this morning as they leave the sanctuary. That will allow us to do two things. One, the congregational meeting for all the members is for the election of a nominating committee, and also to vote on a piece of property or property settlement that is before us. And so we'll be addressing both of those issues at that point in time. Then looking ahead this week, this Wednesday, there is one more class on Islam and Christianity, sort of a review of the things that we've covered over the last several weeks. So we will be looking at that here in the sanctuary Wednesday evening at 6:30. Thursday of this week, the Jet Set group is taking a trip. If you would like to go on that tour of Weaverville, and there's several birthplace and several other locations they'll be going, including the Blue Ridge Parkway. If you would like to go on that, please call the office to sign up. Then the Glory to God hymnal insert is the yellow insert in your bulletin this morning, and we are still taking orders for that. If you would like to make a gift in memory or in honor, or even anonymously, those options are available in that bulletin insert for the new hymnals that we're purchasing. And then finally, you also see in there an insert on the Lenten noon services, which are here in this church. This is a community-wide opportunity. And so you will see that we've got ministers preaching from different congregations during Holy Week, and the theme that follows each one of these Lenten noon devotionals this year is on the cloth and fabric, which is a different angle than we've ever done before, the colors and textures of the faith. Finally, the April 4th Saturday Easter egg hunt will be here at, I believe it's 10:30 in the morning. That information is in your bulletin if you would like to be prepared for the Easter egg hunt for our children. Look in the bulletin for that information. Now let us prepare our hearts for the worship of Almighty God. share with us. Is Emily here? I'm not the only one that overlooked that. Let us have the call to worship. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant.
I will not be like the covenant that they were.
I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts.
And I will be their God, and they shall be my people.
No longer shall they say to each other, "Know the Lord." So loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish but have eternal life. We are forgiven. Praise be to God.
Thank you. Thank you.
be with us today because Ryan had to work. He was called in to work at the last minute, even though we had originally planned for him to be here. In baptism, God claims us and seals us to show that we belong to God. God frees us from sin and death, uniting us with Jesus Christ in his death and resurrection. By water and the Holy Spirit, we are made members of the church, the body of Christ, and joined to Jesus' ministry of love, peace, and justice. Let us remember the joy of our own baptism as we celebrate this sacrament. Brittany, I have a question, several questions for you. I ask you now to reaffirm your faith in being a member of this church. Do you renounce all evil and powers of the world which defy God's righteousness and love? If so, please say I do. Do you renounce the ways of sin that separate you from the love of God?
I do.
And do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Lord and Savior?
I do.
And do you, as a confirmed member of the body of Christ, desire that your children be baptized?
I do.
And now, relying on God's grace, do you promise to live the Christian faith and to teach that faith to your children? Special for these children. So I have a question for you, and that is, will you be a friend to these children and help them to know about Jesus' love? If so, please say we will. Good, good. And will you play with them and help them to learn the stories of the Bible? Good, thank you so much. Let us pray. Eternal and gracious God, in countless ways you revealed yourself in ages past and have blessed us with signs of your grace. We praise you that through the waters of the sea you led your people Israel out of bondage and into freedom in the land of your promise. We praise you for sending Jesus your Son, who for us was baptized in the waters of the Jordan and was anointed as a Christ by your Holy Spirit. Pour out your Spirit upon us and upon this water, that this font may be your place of new birth. May all who now pass through these waters be delivered from death to life, from bondage to freedom, from sin to righteousness, and bind them to the household of faith, guard them from all evil, strengthen them to serve you with joy until the day you make all things new. In Christ's name we pray. And so with the waters that we pour for baptism, these waters bring us the assurance of God's blessing of love and the cleansing of sin. Sandra Michael Austin, I pray God's blessing of the Holy Spirit, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you now and forever. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Now we finally have Alina, and then I'm going to ask Mama to come down the aisle with me so that we can show these new children to this congregation as being part of this community. These are children that we now have agreed to raise and to love and to
I'm going to ask if our children and Marnie, our organist, will lead us in Jesus Loves Me. We all know that.
When she was living in Miami, she worked at the law firm as a receptionist for 24 years, and now she is part-time at a community center, and one of her favorite things to do is working out. I don't know if I told you she's joining my reaffirmation of faith. Over here is Gary and Shelley Pritchard. I'm sure you'll recognize the last name. Their shepherd on your far right is Joseph Pritchard, who is Gary's brother. Gary and Shelley are joined by reaffirmation of faith. They live in Valdez and have in their household, they also have a son, a daughter, son-in-law, and a granddaughter named Maya. Gary works at Broughton as a network manager, and Shelley works at the Department of Social Services in Catawba County. The family enjoys reading, traveling, games, etc. And Joseph will be their shepherd.
Sisters and brothers in Christ, our baptism is a sign and seal of our being cleansed from sin and of being grafted into Jesus. Through the birth, life, death, and resurrection of Christ, the power of sin was broken and God's kingdom entered our world. Through our baptisms, we were made citizens of God's kingdom and freed from the bondage of sin. Let us now celebrate that freedom and redemption through the renewal of the promises which you made at your baptism. Do each of you renounce all evil and the powers in the world which defy God's righteousness and love, if so please say we do. Do you renounce the ways of sin that separate you from the love of God, if so please say I do. Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Lord and Savior, if so please say I do. Will you be Christ's faithful disciple, obeying his word and showing his love to your life's end, if so please say I do.
congregation, do you, the members of the congregation representing the Church of Jesus Christ, promise to guide and nurture these adults who stand before you on this day by word and deed with love and prayer, encouraging them to know and follow Christ and to be faithful members of his church? If you do, please say, we do.
Amen.
Let us pray. Holy God, we praise you for calling us to be a servant people, for gathering us into the body of Christ. We thank you for choosing to add to our number these brothers and sisters in faith. Together may we live in your spirit and so love one another, that we may have the mind of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom we give honor and glory forever. Amen. And now, as a symbol of welcoming these new members into our church, please join us in singing Blessed Be the Tie That Binds, which you'll find in your bulletin.
Time of pastoral prayer and concerns. I want to lift up to you last Sunday during worship, we learned of the death of Helen Smith, who was called out of the service. Helen's mother, I'm sorry, the death of Helen's mother, that's a bad mistake on my part. Anyway, the service was Wednesday at Kaiser. And so please keep Helen in your prayers. Also keep the family of Hugh Fletcher in your prayers, as well as Margaret Blaynott, who experienced deaths in their families recently. And then keep in your prayers Ben Huffman for a hip replacement that occurred last Monday at the VA Center. He's now already down at College Pines. Ken Bumgarner is home, he's back at the Trinity Bridge, and so he is still undergoing therapy there. And Linda Braswell, I had a chance to see her this past week. She is still at a rehab center in Swannanoa, but I have had a chance to visit with her, and she wants to be remembered to this congregation because she is touched very much by your prayers and love and recognizes how much her life is blessed by being part of this congregation. She hopes to be back in this area soon. Let us now turn to God in prayer. Merciful and gracious God, amidst all the busyness of this world, we turn now in the silence of this time, in the stillness of this moment, in the sacredness of this hour, to you for your direction and love. Amidst all the busy words that this world presents and that the chaos in which we encounter as human beings, we ask, O Lord, your guiding spirit and your comforting presence to be with each of us and be with this world. The turmoil that we face through human efforts of hatred, the turmoil that we face through nature's strong hand at work in this world, the turmoil that happens through accidents and through so many ways. We ask, Lord, your guiding comfort to be with those who encounter that turmoil and those who grieve those who have been lost to it. Strengthen us, O God, as your covenant people here at this church. We lift before you the newest members of our congregation who have joined and the newest children who've been baptized this morning, asking your blessing in each of their lives. We acknowledge, O God, that you've called us into a relationship that we are to grow with you every day in our understanding. understanding of Christ's direction as his disciples. And so lead us into a deeper understanding of your will, especially in this Lenten season as we grow closer to Jerusalem and the story of the Passion of Jesus. Guide us, O God, in an understanding of what that means in our lives as we seek to grow closer to you, in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we prepare to hear God's word, let us once again turn to God in prayer. Open to us, O Lord, the joy of our salvation revealed to us through the scriptures, through the gospels, and through the person of Jesus Christ. We ask it in his name. Amen. From John 12. Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew, then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain, but if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it. Those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour. No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." The crowd standing there heard it and said that it was thunder. Others said, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered, "This voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of the world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to indicate the kind of death that he was to die. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
existentialist philosopher Jean-Paul Sartre, entitled The Living Dead. One of the scenes in it illustrates in human terms how easy it is for us to misconstrue our relationship with God. The scene is set in an attic in France during the Second World War. It was a house occupied by the German military as an interrogation center. And they were rounding up members of the French resistance and locking them into the attic of this house where the Nazis were interrogating and abusing the half dozen members of the resistance before they were slated to be killed in the morning. An unexpected event occurs late in the evening. The attic door opens up and the Nazi soldiers throw in a man who's been rounded up in violation of the curfew. His identity and importance is unknown to the Nazis, but the members of the French resistance immediately recognize him as being their leader. Because they caught him out after curfew, the Nazis' plan was simply to interrogate this man and release him in the morning. But all that was assuming that his cover would not be blown by the other members of the resistance who recognized him. With the presence of their leaders, the other prisoners' anxiety turned to courage, and one of them tells their leader, "Don't worry, they will never know your identity from us. We will hold our tongues when they interrogate us again." The leader responds magnanimously to those, "I thank you for myself, for the resistance, and for France. Your courage and your sacrifice will not be forgotten." Suddenly, the female prisoner in their midst, and the audience soon learns that she has been the fiancée of the resistance leader. Anyway, she steps closer to the resistance leader and says this, "Oh, shut up. Nothing you have to say could possibly mean anything to any of us. I'm not blaming you, but the fact is, you're a living man and I'm a dead woman. And the living and the dead have nothing to say to each other. And that fact puts an impenetrable barrier between us." This woman knew that come morning, she and the other resistance fighters would be dead, and he would be released. Within this dramatic moment in the play lies the key to both the play and to our understanding of the suffering of Jesus in our lives. When we in this world consider how leaders in this world, particularly today, appear inauthentic in their leadership because they are more concerned about the next election and about public opinion than they are about making good decisions on behalf of the people of this world, we have an understanding of the difference between authentic leadership and inauthentic leadership. Instead, we see the political jockeying on both sides of the aisle, maneuvering to demonstrate adherence to party principles. But that's not authentic leadership. What this passage and the essential message of the cross of Christ reveals to each of us is that, in contrast to inauthentic leadership, we see impacting the world today, at least on a spiritual level, here in Jesus Christ, and in his crucifixion, this makes sense. This is authentic leadership. His leadership style opens the door between us and a leader with whom we can personally relate. The authenticity of Jesus' ministry and his suffering on the cross establishes solidarity between Christ and the people of God and their own suffering. Christ's suffering on the cross removes from our relationship with God the sense of righteous indignation we have towards leaders who may talk a good talk but really don't know what it's like and what we long for in a leader. The cross reveals to us that God, through Christ, did not bypass human suffering. On contrary, he entered into it and experiences in the totality of human life the full range of suffering and dying on the cross. In Christ, God is rendered vulnerable to human abuse, suffering, And rather than sparing Jesus from any part of the human experience, Jesus will experience the full range of human emotions that accompanies the whole passion story of his death and resurrection, including the rejection and the ridicule, the physical abuse and the exhaustion, the great physical agony endured for many hours, and afterwards his death. With this experience, God has removed all the inseparable barriers between humanity and God. We as humans recognize we can relate to this kind of God because there is no degree of human suffering that we experience that God also has experienced. The first step for us in growing into a deeper relationship of trust in Christ requires us to come face to face with his suffering. We can't grow in Jesus if we bypass the importance and relevance of his suffering and only focus on the resurrected Lord as if that which happens between Palm Sunday and Easter had no relevance at all to us. As we move closer to Holy Week and the cross, we recognize we have to ponder the real meaning of Christ by looking at the suffering again. And behind that issue is even a deeper question for us. If God is capable of suffering and being abused by human beings in Jesus, then how is God still God? In other words, how is God omnipotent? That's a 50-cent word meaning all-powerful. How is that possible? If God suffers and dies, if God suffers, how can God still have the final say when it comes to salvation and resurrection life? To answer these questions, first we have to look at the issue of how authenticity of Christ's suffering helps us to establish a real relationship with God. Rarely are we as blunt with God as the fiancé in Sartre's play was with the resistance leader. And perhaps the reason is we're not angry enough at times with God. Perhaps we aren't as candid and straightforward because we believe that we still have it within us the ability to affect our own destiny, our own future. And so we hold that one at bay. This total dependence upon God. We think there's too much to risk losing if we turn it all over to God. But we turn to Christ for insight here, and he says this, "Now my soul is troubled." Jesus, as a servant leader of his people, knows that suffering is his fate, and it causes great turmoil within him as he ponders it. In no way is Jesus' embrace of suffering a statement that merely glorifies suffering for suffering's sake. He's not saying that all of his suffering is redemptive, only the suffering that he willingly embraces on behalf of others, on behalf of humanity. All of us know people who revel in their own suffering. You know what I'm talking about. They are clear to tell us their aches and their pains, their disappointments in life, their faithful endurance of the troubled times, and oh yes, they remind us no one really cares. And slowly but surely, these folks drive away people whom they love and who love them. We see it happening in our own lives, and you see by the smiles, you know exactly what I'm talking about. This kind of suffering produces the message, pity me, feel sorry for me, indulge me, help me, worry with me, and it quickly pushes people away, if we're honest with ourselves. But there's a very different message in the kind of suffering of Jesus Christ, and we know it implicitly because we know that he's suffering for us. And he does so willingly. And his suffering is not something that he's looking for the pity of the world to endure.
ain't it awful for me? We never hear that from Jesus.
Only one who was without sin could willingly take on the consequences of human sin on behalf of the world. What we see in Jesus is real suffering, but not suffering caused by his own sinfulness. No, it is suffering that is his fate, because he's been called to be the Redeemer, the Restorer, that person who restores all of humanity to God if we turn to that truth. From this perspective, disciples of Jesus in every time or era have discovered that with the presence of the suffering servant, we too can also take on the suffering of others for their well-being. But Jesus takes this suffering into himself and demonstrates to us the redemptive power of new life that comes out of the depths of suffering. There's only one way to endure it. It is to go to the cross. It is to hang from the cross. It is to die at human hands. And to know that that is not the end of the story. From this position of authenticity, we can accept his leadership as the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith. As Jesus faces what he knows will be a time of great suffering ahead, he asks, "And what should I say, Father? Save me from this hour?" No. "It is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." And a voice came from heaven saying, "I have glorified it and I will glorify it again." The arrival of this hour brings real anguish to Jesus. We've got to recognize that. What he does is not a second thought kind of issue. Don't think anything about it, folks. I'm willing to die for you. No, it brings him great anguish. And God in this scripture acknowledges the path Jesus is taking, going to Jerusalem, knowing that it is most painful for him. So much that later in the story we know that his anguish is in profuse sweating that is almost like drops of blood. It is only by entering death that we come face to face with the only power that can transcend death: love. Transformational love that brings new life out of death. That's where we see the real power of Jesus Christ. By willingly dying, he opens the door to eternal life for us and is the first to come through that door. But this morning we've entered the final stretch of Jesus' ministry. Ahead of us is all of that. But the scripture passage that we look at today in John 12 enables us to enter into that in thought and be anticipating what that means for our lives as we prepare ourselves. To know that this great suffering of Jesus Christ was done willingly, but with great anguish and great, great tragedy in his life, and also with great joy, the outcome of what God alone is able to do. There we see the connecting point between us and between Jesus. He is the authentic leader we long for. He's been there first. And from the cross, we hear the words that all of us can't relate to as human beings. Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Even there, he goes willingly. And where do we find God in the midst of that? Suffering on a cross, dying on a cross, and knowing that that is not the end, because on Easter Sunday, God is present still in a resurrection, in new life that we can claim for ourselves. the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Every time that we baptize into the community of faith, we are called to share together in the Apostles' Creed. So I invite you to stand and join with me as we share together the Apostles' Creed, which I believe is on page 14 in your hymnal if you're not familiar with it. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins,
the blessing of life that you've given to us in Jesus Christ, for the freedom from sin that we experience in his love and through our baptisms. Use us in these gifts for your purpose in this world. In Jesus' name. I think it's remarkable as our guests are leaving that two families were here in great numbers to support their family members who joined our church, and we are thankful for that. I'd like to call on the clerk. Do we have a quorum, Mr. Clerk, to conduct our meeting? We have a quorum present. Let us open the meeting in prayer. Merciful God, as we are your people, claimed by your love, redeemed by your grace, and redeemed by our Lord, we ask you to be present with us as we conduct the business of this meeting today. In Jesus' name, amen. The purpose of the meeting is therefore twofold. And the first is to hear the report of the nominating committee. Now, I will tell you that as our Presbyterian system, the way the nominating process works for a nominating committee is that each one of the committees identifies a member of its committee
on alternate years so that we have half of the committees represented with the nominating committee. And so it is still the responsibility, not of the session, but of the congregation, to elect the nominating committee to perform the duties of identifying new elders and deacons to serve this congregation. That's the first part of our agenda. And Carolyn Williams is with us this morning to share with us the slate of nominees for the nominating committee.
Mr. Moderator, on behalf of the 2014 nominating committee, I would like to make a motion that the following be elected to the 2015 nominating committee. These candidates represent the Christian Relations, Worship, Personnel, Fellowship, and Missions Committees, elders and deacons, and also the youth. If you would please stand as I call your names: Amy Bonner, Mary Ann Cannon, Britt Simmons, David Anderson, Wes Garu, Christy Benoos, Mark Pons, Alan Griffin, and Bart Benoos.
Don't let the fact that several of them are not here be disconcerting to you. We knew they wouldn't be here. But the report is before us. You may be seated. Before us now at this time, it does not need a second because it comes from the committee. Are we ready to vote? All those in favor of electing this nominating committee to serve in the selection of elders and deacons to bring back to us a slate this fall, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The motion carries. And with that, I want to thank Carolyn Williams, who has served on this committee for several years and will now be rotating off with this act, and I know you're delighted.
Thank you.
The second part of our meeting is to address a matter of property. And that is with the property that was given to the church. Louise Gigu Cox was the estate, a piece of property in Greensboro. It is a long and arduous story to recite, and I will not go into great detail. I will say, we did not know we even received this gift until after the city of Greensboro told us that it had burned and that we were liable as a church to have the property razed or repaired. What a nice way of finding out that we've been given a gift. That happened 3 years ago, 3+ years ago now, and since then we have been addressing this through legal proceedings because not only was the property burned, it also had a reverse mortgage against it. And so in addition to that, because we were not notified that we owned the property at the time of the woman's death, but only months later, there was a error in the way that the executor lawyer handled the estate. So we've been in court now, not in court, but in dialogue with each other and had to hire lawyers to assist us in this process over the last 3 years. I had black hair when I started this process, and I don't anymore. But I will tell you this, we have come to a resolution, and we have heard back from the lawyers of the estate, and there has been a recommendation that comes to us that Frank is now going to share with us at this time.
Okay, first of all, do you folks know who Louise Gigu Cox is? Does that name ring a bell? If I'm not mistaken, Louise Gigu Cox was John Harvey Gigu's sister. Is that right, Steve? If you remember, John Harvey was very active in our church, had a big deal with the Boy Scouts, and was a longtime member of our church, so this would be John Harvey Gigu's sister. On February 22nd, the trustees of the corporation met and reviewed a detailed settlement agreement for the resolution of the Louise Cox estate. The settlement agreement is about 8 pages long, and I'll not read that, obviously. What I have done is tried to condense that into about three or four sentences that we presented to the trustees a month ago, and I'll read that for lack of the ability to do this without reading it verbatim, but I tried to condense it into a sentence or two that we might be able to understand. The settlement agrees for the co-executors to deliver a check to HUD in the amount of the insurance payment and transfer the title of the property to HUD. The co-executors will issue a check to Waldensian Presbyterian in the amount of $15,000. Importantly, HUD agrees not to pursue any action against WPC for any deficiency pertaining to the reverse mortgage, and also agrees not to pursue any claims against WPC, and thus holds us harmless for all claims asserted by government entities, including but not limited to the City of Greensboro, for post-fire housing code and or building code violations. And that's important. Also included is to render WPC harmless in regard to alleged violations regarding the City of Greensboro housing complaint and notice to make repairs. So that's a little bit of the background of the settlement agreement. So the motion that I put forth to the trustees of the corporation on February 22nd was this. It was the approval to accept the settlement agreement in the matter of the estate of Louise G. Cox. The settlement agreement is between William J. Moore and Jane Moore, co-executors of the estate, Waldensian Presbyterian Church and HUD. So that agreement has been approved by the trustees. Two other motions that the trustees approved were the details of the settlement, and I'll just briefly tell you what those are or were. The second motion that was passed was to approve the payment to Stephen J. Grabenstein, who is our lawyer in Asheville working out of Van Winkle Law Firm, a sum of $5,000 for his work on the case. The second lawyer we employed was Michael Begley from Black Mountain, and Michael will get his reimbursement from Mr. Grabenstein per their agreement. I don't know how much that will be. Now, just a little bit of background on the cost to the church. When we started out this whole process, the lawyers promised us their fee would not be more than $5,000. The total bill ended up being $8,000. However, the lawyers told us that they would accept only $3,000 as payment, which is an absolute bargain. However, we had really planned on paying $5,000, so that's what we agreed to do. So we will net $10,000 out of the settlement agreement. The $10,000 will be allocated to the unrestricted portion of the endowment fund, which is typically how we handle property settlements, and it's the same way that fund received the same type of treatment from the sale of the property on Italy Street. So that brings us to what we need from you all today. It's really nothing more than rubber stamping the motion that the trustees have already approved. Really, we need your authorization to sign the settlement agreement on behalf of the congregation. So I'll place this motion on the floor.
All right.
And it will not need a second. And the motion is to authorize the terms of the settlement agreement regarding the Louise G. Cox estate, previously approved by the trustees of the corporation on February 22nd, 2015, and to direct the trustees to sign on behalf of the congregation. Mr. Moderator, the motion is on the floor and does not need a second, so we can entertain any discussion at this point.
Are there any questions? I realize that as complex as this issue has been for us as a pastor and several church leaders who've worked with me over the last 3 years on this, this probably is so foreign to you. But essentially, what you have here is that HUD was the one who made the reverse mortgage loan to this woman, Louise Gigan Cox. And so they have a hand in this. That's why they are getting the settlement of the insurance because of the malpractice issue that we recognize. We are getting a settlement out of this of $15,000 without any encumbrances to that. So that's where we are. Are there any other questions?
And just as an aside, HUD is getting $68,750 out of this deal. It was $69,000. There's a $250 deductible on the insurance payment. So HUD is getting $68,750. That sounds like a bargain, but they're now the owners of a property that needs to be destroyed, so I'm not sure it's that much of a bargain.
Yeah, and we're cleared of Greensboro. We've been served notice from the city of Greensboro twice that we should have that taken care of, otherwise face a $50 fine. We cleared that hurdle, but here now we're ready to settle, and so we recommend the settlement. Are there any questions? Seeing none, are we ready to vote? I think we're ready to be rid of this. All those in favor of this settlement, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thanks be to God. And I will tell you, one of the things we learned from this is that in the future, we now have a policy in this church that says it is up to the session to accept a piece of property first before we are told that we own something. We have the right of refusal. And so from this point forward, we will recognize that that is part of our responsibility if we see that there are problems with it like this. Chances are we'll never see this again because it's a once in a million type of situation. But I'm glad we're nearing the end. Having conducted the business, there is nothing else for us to conduct at this point in time, so I will entertain a motion for the congregation that we adjourn.
Second.
It's been moved, seconded.
Second.
All those in favor of the motion, please stand. Looks unanimous, we're ready to go. Blessings on you as you begin this week, and may God's love guide you.
I don't know what you're doing.
I don't know what you're doing.